Hi students, welcome to Alfo's e-learning chemistry classes for second year. The running chapter is electrochemistry and now we are in fourth session. Okay, and before entering into these today's concepts, just let me give the highlighted points of the previous session. In previous session, what we discussed is the products that form at electrodes, in the electrolysis of different electrolytes. Just let me give few points related to that as a review. Here, in case if we are electrolyzing NaCl fused condition, the two ions that will form is cation and anion, like this. And as we know, only one ion is present in this at cathode and anode, thereby they will get discharged like this. There is no competition for these ions at respective electrodes. But in case if we are using NaCl aqueous solution, here when it is split into Na plus and Cl minus ions, in both these two electrodes, that is simply we can say it is at cathode, just you remember, and it is at anode. Here, for this Na plus ion, water will be in competition to get reduced. And for this chloride ion, water will be in competition to get oxidized. And of these two, here, instead of sodium, this water will release hydrogen. It is nothing but because of preferential discharge theory. Clear? And now, in case of this, here also, when chlorine is of getting competition from water, even though from water to release oxygen, less discharge potential is required, still chlorine will be released, but not oxygen. This could be explained with the phenomenon over voltage. If you recollect, that over voltage is nothing but a kinetic factor that operates. Clear? And now, one more concept what we discussed is, in case of some inert electrodes involved, all these reactions we can assume. And now, we have to consider the participation of active electrodes. When active electrode is involved, active electrode, already we know, it is nothing but the electrode which is made from the metal which already present in the electrolyte. So in such active electrode participation, and if you remember, active electrode is active only at anode, it never be active at cathode. So to understand this active electrode condition, first of all we have to consider AgNO3 solution, aqueous solution. In such a case, at anode, only at anode, because this active electrode is participating at anode. That's why we are discussing only that. At anode, NO3 minus is ready to go for oxidation. And being the aqueous solution, water is also ready to go for oxidation to release oxygen. And then this active electrode silver metal is also ready to go for oxidation by releasing electron to give Ag plus. So when active electrode is participated, so we are not following the preferential discharge theory, even though it is participating, but now this silver, that is active electrode, is involved in the reaction even in the presence of water. So, and this is happened only at anode, and because of the participation of this anode in electrolysis process, this anode metal rod will dissolve in the electrolyte. That phenomenon, what we are considering is anodic dissolution. This what we discussed yesterday, all this, clear? And preferential discharge theory, and here and there it is violated. It is nothing but because of over voltage. And now coming to active electrode participation, and you remember forever, electrode will be active only at anode, and in due course that anode will dissolve in the solution. That's why it is known as anodic dissolution.
these are the factors we discussed yesterday. And now, today, we are going to discuss one more factor that will operate for the electrode products. That is nothing but effect of concentration of electrolytes. And you remember, it is of one of the important topic where we can expect competitive exam questions. Logical questions are there here to observe the effect of concentration of the electrolyte. First, let me give the best example for this. As we know, H2SO4, familiar to us, its aqueous solution is meant for electrolysis. So in this electrolysis, what will happen? Let us observe. First of all, H2SO4 will split into H plus and SO4 minus. And this cation at cathode will get electrons and reduce into H2. There is no doubt. But related to this SO4 minus 2 ion, at anode, what is happening is, at anode, SO4 minus 2, by releasing electrons, that is, it is ready to get oxidized into S2O8 minus 2. And its electrode potential E0 is 1.96 volts. And being the aqueous solution, here water is also ready to get oxidation, where it releases O2 and H+. And as we know, electrode potential here is 1.23 volts. So now the question, if we are following preferential discharge theory, oxygen should be released. Is it not? If we are considering overvoltage phenomena, this should happen. Again, preferential discharge theory, as per preferential discharge theory, oxygen should release. And whereas, if it is of taking overvoltage phenomena, this will happen at anode. And now, how to consider it? Of these two, which we have to consider? For that purpose, you remember, in considering this effect of concentration, this here, you observe, it is E0. E0 is given. What does it mean? Just you remember, E0 is nothing but standard electrode potential. Standard electrode potential. And one more term is there, that is E. E is nothing but electrode potential. And now, let me make you to understand what is the difference between these two. What is electrode potential? What is standard electrode potential? For that purpose, first let us make you to know what is electrode potential. Just you remember, any metal, it is nothing but the nature. By birth, by nature, by virtue, the metals are having the tendency to develop some sort of potential around its rod. That is, when a metal rod is dipped in its salt solution, these metals are having the tendency, we need not do any other thing, just we are dipping the metal rod in its salt solution. Say for example, zinc, dipped in zinc sulfate, or copper, dipped in its copper sulfate, or silver in its silver nitrate solution, like that. When a metal rod is deeper in its salt solution, some sort of potential will be developed around this. That potential is known as electrode potential. Electrode potential, just you remember. We are not doing any other chemical reaction by our activity. It is just by its birth, by its virtue, by its nature, it is developing, it is having that tendency. That potential developed around this metal rod is electrode potential. Clear? And now, in case, if the metal rod is dipped in its salt solution of 1 molar concentration, just in previous case, we are not confining the concentration. Just we are saying that when a metal rod is deeper in its salt solution, some sort of potential will develop, and that potential is electrode potential. There we are not mentioning any concentration term. But Here, if the metal rod is deeper in its salt solution of 1 molar, that is unity concentration, the potential developed is known as standard electrode potential, measured or represented as E naught. Are you clear? Again, I am defining standard electrode potential is nothing but the potential developed when a metal rod is dipped in its salt solution of unit concentration, that is nothing but 1 molar concentration. And now, electrode potential, it is nothing but the potential developed around that electrode when that metal rod is dipped in its salt solution of concentration other than unity. That means other than 1 molar, it may be more or less. Say for example, if we are dipping the electrode in 2 molar concentration, then the product is nothing but electrode potential. And in case if we are dipping it in 0.5 molar, then it is electrode potential. So simply you can remember, if it is 1 molar concentration, standard electrode potential. If it is other than 1 molar concentration, more or less, irrespective of that, it should be other than 1 molar, then it is electrode potential. Now clear? So when we are observing the effect of concentration, instead of the standard electrode potentials, we have to consider electrode potentials. And now, standard electrode potential, you remember, standard electrode potential is an intrinsic property. I think you know from thermodynamics, intrinsic property, it is not depending on the external factor. It is not depending on the quantity of the material present in this system. Is it not? So it is an intrinsic property. Whereas, electrode potentials are extrinsic properties. That means, they depend on the quantity of the substance, that is electrolyte present in the solution. That's why it is not fixed value. It depends on the electrode potential, depends on the dilution. Clear? Or depends on the concentration. Now, so when these electrode potentials are considered to observe the effect of concentration, now which of these two reactions will take place? If they ask, it is very, very important question. And now you remember, in case if we are using concentrated solution, concentrated H2SO4 is taken, this reaction, that is sulfate getting into sulfate, is disulfate, is preferable when it is concentrated solution. And if it is dilute solution, if we are considering less concentrated, dilution means less concentrated solution, in such a case this reaction is preferable. Are you clear? So a dilute solution, in case if they are asking the question related to, in case if we are electrolyzing dilute H2SO4 solution, what will the product at anode? Simply you can say oxygen. In case if it is considered, if a concentrated H2SO4 solution is electrolyzed, what will be the product at anode? Then it is nothing but disulfate. Clear? So like that, the concentration will influence the electrode product again. These are the different factors that influence the electrode products. And here one more question, let me make you to recollect. Already we discussed regarding the preparation of H2O2 from dilute, that is from electrolysis of H2SO4. If you recollect, there what we are using is 50% H2SO4 solution. 50% means it is concentrated solution. That's why we are expecting this type of reaction at anode, not this. Clear? And again, you remember, in H2O2 preparation, we are using 50% H2O2 solution, and that 50% H2O2 solution is considered as concentrated solution. And thereby, we are expecting this type of reaction, that is related to H2O2 preparation. Okay. Now, in this session, one more thing. With all these, what are the products that are formed? Is nothing but it is this we discuss. Now we have to discuss the theories related to theories of electrolysis. The theories related to electrolysis. We are having two theories. One is Arrhenius theory. Arrhenius theory of electrolyte And second one is Ostwald's dilution law. Dilution law. Arrhenius' theory of electrolyte and Ostwald's dilution law. You remember, finally, we will conclude that both these two are related to weak electrolytes. Weak electrolyte, already I think you know, weak electrolyte is nothing but which undergoes ionization less than 100%. So these two are preferably applicable only for weak electrolytes. Why so? First, let us discuss about this Arrhenius theory. As per Arrhenius theory, any electrolyte like AB is dissolved in water, it will undergo dissociation to form such type of ions, cation and anion, which will establish an equilibrium with the undissociated molecules. So that's why we are already considering it is applicable for weak electrolyte. And if you recollect, if it is strong electrolyte, there is no such type of equilibrium. Just all the molecules of the electrolyte will completely ionize. But it is not happening here. That's why we are saying that these two are related to weak electrolytes. Clear? In this one, when this electrolyte is taken in aqueous solution, the properties of this electrolyte depends on the ions that are present in the solution. So, as per Arrhenius theory, the properties of the electrolytes are due to the ions present in this solution. And now, this, when it is of in equilibrium, we may consider the equilibrium constant K is nothing but A plus concentration into B minus concentration by AB concentration. And now, as per Arrhenius theory, when the properties of the electrolytes depend on the ions present in the solution, how many ions will present in the solution? It is nothing but the fraction of ions. The fraction of ions that present in the solution, electrolyte solution, is nothing but known as degree of dissociation or degree of ionization. Degree of dissociation or degree of ionization represented with the letter alpha. And now alpha, the formula is nothing but number of molecules that split into ions, number of molecules split into ions by total number of molecules dissolved. This is nothing but degree of dissociation or degree of ionization. So because of this, the percentage of degree, now the question will be how it will be influenced, how the degree of dissociation will be influenced. The factors that influence the degree of dissociation are nothing but one is temperature and the other one is concentration and third one is nature of solute and solvent. Let us discuss these factors influence on degree of dissociation one by one. Temperature. When temperature increase, automatically degree of dissociation will increase because dissociation is an endothermic process. So automatically when temperature is provided to this electrolyte, the dissociation will increase. So alpha is proportional to T. And now concentration. Here let me make you to understand, and you have to forever remember it. Concentration means the concentration of the electrolyte we are discussing. And you remember, concentration of electrolyte means we are not considering the concentration of the ions. These two concentrations, generally, in general terms, when a substance is present in the solution, we are considering both these two, that is AB as well as A plus B minus. All these total, how many molecules dissolved, that is considered for the concentration terms. But here in electrochemistry, when we are considering the concentration of the electrolyte, that we are considering only the molecules present in the molecular form, that is the concentration of the electrolyte. not ions. Let me explain with a simple example. Say for example NaCl. NaCl, it is true and strong electrolyte. That means when it is dissolved in water, what happens? In the beginning, it is 100 molecules. Say for example, in the beginning, all these are existing and its concentration is 100. And now when it is dissolved, all these are completely dissociated into ions. And it now becomes, molecular form of NaCl becomes zero. In such a case, what will be the concentration of NaCl? It is zero. Clear? In terms of liquid solution, when how many moles of NaCl is dissolved, whether it immaterial to that, whether it is existing in molecular form or ionic form, just we are considering the amount of NaCl dissolved. But here concentration doesn't mean like that. When the amount is dissolved in the electrolyte, in the solution or in a solvent, then we have to consider the concentration of the electrolyte only when it exists as a molecular form. In case of strong electrolytes, the concentration will become zero immediately because they are undergoing 100% ionization. Clear? And now, in case of weak electrolyte, such thing is not happening because they never undergo 100% ionization. In such a case, some part of the undissociated molecules will exist and very, very little extent of the dissociation will take place in weak electrolytes. That's why very, very limited amounts of these ions will exist. Clear? And now, that concentration term can also be considered as dilution. And you remember, when dilution is nothing but addition of solvent, more and more solvent when added, it is said to be the solution is diluted. So when dilution increase, concentration of the electrolyte decrease automatically. Clear? Concentration of the electrolyte decrease means ions number increase. Why concentration of electrolyte is coming down? Because when dilution happens, more and more number of molecules are dissociating in ions. So here you have to observe the difference between the concentration of the ions and the molecules. When dilution takes place, when more solvent is added to the solution, then the number of molecules slowly decrease because more ionization takes place, and whereas number of ions will increase. So now when these two observed, here it is number of molecules split automatically increase. That's why here this degree of dissociation is proportional to dilution. With increasing dilution, automatically degree of dissociation increase. Next one, nature of solute and solvent. As we know already in the previous sessions, we discussed about the solute. If solute is ionic, it is strong electrolyte, automatically more number of ions will be produced. If it is polar, then that means polar means it is not partially ionic, partially covalent. In such a case, they establish an equilibrium. So more polar, more the possibility for the generation of the ions. And now in such a case, ionic compounds or polar compounds, the solvent nature is one of the important factors. Here solvent, more dielectric constant. The solvent with more dielectric constant will make more dissociation. That means in case of more dielectric constant solvents, we can expect more degree of dissociation. These are the three factors that influence degree of dissociation. Clear? And now when it is dissociating like this and establishing, if with that alpha, that is degree of dissociation, we are considering this dissociation constant. Here the equilibrium constant is nothing but dissociation constant, you remember. And now how to consider the dissociation constant with degree of dissociation? In the beginning, say for example, if it is C and these are zero, and at equilibrium C minus C alpha, it is generating C alpha and C alpha. And as we know, K is nothing but A plus into B minus by AB concentrations. Thereby, it is nothing but equal to C alpha into C alpha by C into 1 minus alpha, we can write. And now, when it is nothing but C alpha square by 1 minus alpha, this is equal to K. That K is known as dissociation constant or ionization constant. Clear? That K. That is about Arrhenius theory. And now coming to Ostwald's dilution law. It is nothing but related to this. We discussed already about the concentration, the effect of concentration on degree of dissociation. That means the effect of dilution. And it is formulated by Ostwald. Now let us consider this Ostwald's dilution law. Ostwald's dilution law. Here, as per Arrhenius theory, if AB is the weak electrolyte, it is able to establish equilibrium in water where it is forming A plus aqueous ion and B minus aqueous ion. If alpha is the degree of dissociation at equilibrium, C minus C alpha, C alpha and C alpha, and equilibrium constant, that is dissociation constant, is A plus into B minus by AB, and when these values are introduced, it is C alpha, C alpha by C into 1 minus alpha, and now we are coming to C alpha square by 1 minus alpha. This is Arrhenius. And now in continuation to this, as per Ostwald's, in case of weak electrolytes, the degree of dissociation is negligible compared to 1. So when alpha is negligible, automatically we can consider K is C alpha square. And now here let us guess that if one mole of electrolyte dissolved in V volume, then automatically concentration is nothing but 1 by V. So when C is 1 by V, if we are substituting this value here, K is equal to alpha square by V, or alpha square degree of dissociation is equal to KV, or alpha is equal to root KV, and if we are considering root K is nothing but a nu constant, then alpha is equal to K bar into nu or V, or simply we can say alpha is proportional to root nu. This is Ostwald's dilution law. Simply, as per Ostwald's dilution law, the degree of dissociation of weak electrolytes is proportional to the square root of dilution. It is proportional to the square root of dilution. That is Ostwald's dilution law. And remember, it is applicable only for weak electrolytes. In case of strong electrolytes, it is the concentration of electrolyte will become zero. So automatically there is no effect of dilution. That's why in case of strong electrolytes, this dilution law totally failed. It is applicable only for weak electrolytes. You remember, and the relation you have to remember, that is the degree of dissociation is proportional to square root of dilution. Just it is nothing but when we are increasing the volume by 4 times by adding the solvent, then the degree of dissociation will become double. Like that it is proportional. Clear? That is about the laws related to electrolysis. In the coming sessions, with all these discussions, what we observed up to now is ions are migrating towards the oppositely charged electrodes. In their migration, they are carrying their charges. So when they are carrying their charges, they are responsible for conductance. Till now, we have discussed only which ion will migrate towards which one and which is getting discharged at electrodes, like that. And now we have to discuss about when they are carrying the charges, that means when they are conducting the electricity, how much of conductance they can carry, and what are different parameters to consider the conductance, how many types of conductances we can observe in electrolytes, all these.